News starts right now.
And we start tonight with a staggering number, 5,641 victims of child abuse reported in Bexar County last year alone. Advocates will tell you child abuse is an epidemic in Bexar County.
Now the county's children's court is getting some relief with its tremendous caseload. A new associate judge has now been appointed. Judge Raul Perales began presiding over cases last month. He spoke with our Erica Hernandez about his current role and presiding over some of Child Protective Services' worst cases.
The number of child abuse cases in Bexar County has been a concern for years. Last year alone, 13 kids died because of severe abuse and neglect. Previously, Children's Court had two judges that would handle the caseload, but because of the increase in caseload, Judge Perales was appointed, and now he will be handling those cases that are dealing with domestic violence and abuse.
It is taxing, but it's necessary work, and it is a problem that's getting worse.
It's a problem Judge Perales is hoping to tackle more head-on.
There's a lot of resources out there, and I'm excited to point families to the proper resources that can help us achieve success.
And while admitting that it's not a perfect system, he says the common goal among all working on these cases is keeping children safe.
The broken bones and the bruises, those heal, but the trauma that's left, the psychological scars that are left, those fester and they get worse. And unless they're addressed with the children, it's going to continue. That cycle is going to continue.
Erica Hernandez, KSAT 12 News.
The man accused of shooting and killing an elementary school teacher is now out on bond. Bexar County jail records show that 25-year-old Matthew Weising was released yesterday. He's being charged for the murder of a teacher from Great Hearts Forest Heights. 23-year-old Michael Echanis was killed in March. The superintendent of Great Hearts, Texas, says that Weising is on house arrest and required to wear an ankle monitor now. He also says police will continue to be on campus. The suspect's pretrial hearing is scheduled for April 26th.
A woman behind bars tonight following a car chase and crash. This all happening just before 2 this morning on Wurzbach Road near I-10 and Vance Jackson. That's on the northwest side. BCSO says a deputy tried pulling the woman over when she sped away. Deputies chased for about 8 minutes before she crashed into a pole in front of that apartment complex. According to BCSO, the woman had a felony warrant for her arrest. She's now being charged with evading police, along with the possibility of a DWI.
The search now continuing tonight for a 20-year-old murder suspect in Seguin. Draven Reyes is accused in the fatal shooting of Makailan Smith. She died Monday after being shot at a baseball court at Park West. A second person, an 18-year-old man, was also injured. Today we've learned that two others involved in that shooting were arrested yesterday, accused of being involved in that shooting. If you've got any information about this case, call Guadalupe County Crime Stoppers at 877-403-8477.
San Antonio police asking for the public's help in identifying an aggravated robbery suspect. This incident happened on March 30th, about 4 in the afternoon at a Home Depot on Fair Avenue. Police said the suspect showed a weapon to one of the workers before stealing merchandise from the store. This is a picture of who they're looking for. Anyone with information asked to call Crime Stoppers at 210-224-STOP.
The San Antonio City Council today agreeing to settle what could have been an even costlier lawsuit, all centered around sanctuary cities. The state sued the city, the police department, the police chief, and the city manager over what happened in late 2017. Suspected undocumented immigrants caught up in a human smuggling bust were released and not handed over to the feds. The state will drop this lawsuit and another that aimed to remove Chief William McManus from his job. The lawsuit has already cost the city $6.4 million on these cases and a related investigation. And now the city will pay $300,000 to the state in this settlement. Now, if the city had lost at trial, it could have owed more than $150 million. The city also agreed to make changes to SAPD's written policies.
Just some specific language, I think, in the manual is changing, but from a practical standpoint, nothing has changed in terms of how we would handle these situations going forward.
Now, despite the settlement, the city attorney maintains that the police chief did not have the authority to detain the suspected immigrants after they had been interviewed. The settlement does not require the city to admit any fault.
Thousands of dollars in music equipment stolen in a matter of minutes. A local musician woke up Tuesday morning to find his trailer filled with musical instruments gone. RJ Marquez caught up with this musician who had his week begin on a rough note.
They hit a speed bump and broke off. We found it a couple of blocks away.
That part of local musician Zeke Escobedo's trailer was all that was left behind after thieves stole it early Tuesday morning.
There was nothing left but a trail going down the street where they dragged the trailer.
Escobedo said the trailer had more than $18,000 worth of music equipment inside when it was taken from the front yard of his far west side home.
Speakers, power amps, whole set of drums, that's $3,500 worth.
San Antonio police told us this theft case remains under investigation, but officers did give Escobedo some better news this morning.
Police called Mr. Escobedo to say that they had recovered his stolen trailer. There was damage inside and everything was also missing, but they did leave one thing.
The only thing they left was a tip jar. They didn't even leave a tip or nothing.
Escobedo has been in the local music scene for decades, playing country music with his band Burgundy. He's never experienced anything like this.
You work hard for all this, you know, to buy all this equipment. To have somebody just come and take it away, and, you know, I can't say the names that I called them.
He said Burgundy has some gigs lined up in the near future, and many fellow musicians have offered to help the band out.
My friends and everything have called me and said, hey, don't worry about it. We got your back, so I'm good.
RJ Marquez, KSAT 12 News.
The Fiesta Fun rolls on this week, and tonight is the first night of Fiesta San Fernando.
Yeah, that's where we find Patty Santos at Main Plaza, where the proceeds go to help San Fernando Cathedral. Patty.
Yeah, you got your chicken on a stick, you got your gorditas, you got turkey legs, but have you guys tried birria? Well, you can do that here at Fiesta San Antonio. Here joining me right now is Natalia Gomez. Natalia, what does birria taste like?
Birria tastes like something very wonderful that you need to try. You need to come out and try and check what it's about.
Yeah, it's a little different. You guys, this is the first time you guys are here.
Yes, this is the first time we're ever out in public like this.
Yeah, a lot of people, they know about them because of social media, but now you can actually try it. And a lot of the people that are here, their clients, they come back and they're smiling. They're ready for this. Take a look. He's preparing that right now, right here. And Eloise, tell me when people can enjoy the festivities here.
Well, we'll be here till midnight tonight. And then tomorrow we start bright and early at 10 a.m. to midnight. And then Saturday we're 10 a.m. to 1 a.m. For those that are maybe at the parade, they can swing by because the parade ends a little later when they get to this point. So we'll be here.
And you were telling me this is one of the selling points for folks to come and try something different.
Exactly. This is my very first time seeing birria tacos. I had to learn how to say that. And I've tried mine for the first time. Delish.
What does it taste like? Really quick.
Well, like a quesadilla, but with beef.
Yeah, but really savory.
But savory, and the way they marinate the tortilla and the meat is awesome.
You got to add all the
fixings.
Yeah, all the fixings.
That's
all right.
That's
well,
right.
You're going to have to, can we show folks before we go over there? And the fixings are right next to it. You're going to have to come by and try it, guys. We'll send it back to you.
Oh, birria is so good.
It does look really good.
Thanks, Patty.
By the way, the Fiesta Fun doesn't stop there. Also going on tonight, the 84th Fiesta Band Festival.
Now let's send things over to Mike Osterhage and Fiona Gorostiza live at Alamo Stadium. Hey, guys.
How are you?
Oh, my goodness. I tell you, the excitement, incredible right now here.
Yeah, because they haven't had this in about 3 years, since back in 2019. And of course, 30 bands are going to be taking the field in just about 15 minutes or so. Southwest Legacy's out there. They're going to be kicking things off in just a couple of minutes.
And as Mike said, it's been 3 years since this event. So for a lot of these kids, this is their first time doing this event. And seniors were freshmen the last time this event happened.
Yeah, so the vast majority of the kids are going to be out here tonight competing, and this is quite a competition. They have not been on this field, and of course, they're all going to be streaming on through here, and then the sight to behold is the grand finale when about 4,000 band members take the field. You cannot see any green on that field, and they all finish off the show all together.
And that is absolutely spine-tingling to watch.
And if you, speaking of watching, if you want to catch it, it is going to be streaming on KSAT.com, KSAT TV, tonight on the back of the official program right here. And then it's going to be rebroadcast Saturday from 2 to 5. It is so fun to be out here, and it couldn't be a more perfect evening.
Viva Fiesta!
Gonna be a good night.
Yeah, it is.
Well,
Mike,
it sounds that way too.
Yeah, Mike Fiona, thank you.
Another huge Fiesta event now less than 24 hours away, the Battle of Flowers Parade. It makes its way through downtown tomorrow morning, and thousands of flowers adorn more than 20 of the floats, each flower matching the gowns of the Order of the Alamo Court and this year's theme.
But how do the flowers take shape? Alicia Barrera visited with the woman who has helped carry on the tradition of handmade flowers for more than 50 years now.
These are the delicate hands and quick moving fingers that create the Fiesta magic on board each Battle of Flowers float.
It varies on whose float you're working on.
Rose Garcia is the lead flower maker for the parade.
We do one by one.
A craft she picked up in the 70s thanks to her beloved mama, Genevieve.
She was an employee, just like the rest of my cousins and aunts.
52 years later.
Then in 90, I was hired to be their boss.
She could fill a box with paper blooms with her eyes closed.
Yes, I'm talking to you and I'm making the flowers.
And Miss Rose can probably do this with her eyes closed, but she says that anyone that walks through these doors can do it too. And here's its trick. You want to do three pleats, loose pleats, and then you're going to wrap it and then repeat the process. One, two, three, wrap. And here's why she says it doesn't always have to be perfect.
And that float is going by so fast.
And this year's parade is even more special for Rose as she's set to retire.
I think it's time for me to let somebody else walk in and start.
She'll get to ride away surrounded by the very same flowers she made on board her own float.
Our family members in the past have walked through these doors, did it, and retired, and never has any one of them, not even our bosses before me. I get to do it. I'll be the first.
That was our Alicia Barrera reporting there, and those floats are so beautiful. I can't wait to see them tomorrow.
Yeah, we're going to have to look out for her on the float.
I know.
Tomorrow. All right, by the way, talk about this weather.
The forecast for Battle of Flowers, too. I keep getting so confused by a cold front for Battle of Flowers.
Should we be telling people to bring a jacket?
You know, if you're out there on the parade route early, yeah, I would recommend having a light coat or long sleeves because the Vanguard starts at 8:55 a.m. And at that point, it's going to be about 57 degrees. By 11 a.m., we're at 70 degrees, 1 p.m., 75. So, you know, have some layers. You'll want short sleeves basically soon after the parade starts. But I know a lot of people line the parade route quite a bit before the parade actually commences. So it's going to be relatively cool compared to what we're used to for Battle of Flowers. We'll talk about exactly how cold at sunrise tomorrow and where in just a bit, along with how temperatures rise and when our next chance of storms is coming up.
Thank you, Adam. All right, let's check out traffic right now. 612, this is I-10 and La Quintera. You can see I-10 itself, not bad, but they actually have an accident, looks like, in the median there. So they've closed the on-ramp onto I-10 at La Quintera. That's where this camera is, so it's a little farther down. But you can see they've closed the on-ramp. That means the access road very congested right now. Looks like some sort of accident in the median between the access road and I-10 itself. Again, the on-ramp is blocked there. It's not affecting I-10. It's affecting the I-10 access road, though, very much so right now.
Mm-hmm. Still ahead here at 6, more Fiesta means more medals. We'll check in with meteorologist Katie Blake and Sarah Spivey live at Mission Marquee Plaza for a Fiesta medal giveaway.
I'm Dylan Collier. Coming up, a tragic death at a facility that treats wounded veterans. What happened and how his family says his death could have been prevented. That's on the Night Beat.
We got some breaking news that we're following right now. Sky 12 over the scene of a grass fire. We're told this is at South Presa and East Highland. It's not too far from the I-10 and 37 interchange there. Obviously, an area with a lot of grass, a lot of trees in this area.
And it's just so dry out there. It does not take much to spark one of these. Again, does not look like it's very big right now as far as acreage, but it does look like there are firefighters on the scene. Again, it's the general area of South Presa and East Highland, kind of in the I-10, I-37 area, as Myra said.
As we keep an eye on that, we are going to go out to two people who know all about these dry conditions. And today they're focused on that, but also giving away some medals.
Yeah, and having fun. Let's check in with Katie and Sarah. They are live from Mission Marquee Plaza. Hi, guys.
Hey guys, yeah, we have had such a wonderful time here at Mission Marquee Plaza with Metro Health. Great crowd here that got some Fiesta medals, yeah. We had so many medals, we started to give out vintage medals from the years past.
Yes.
So with me, I have Miguel Cervantes with Metro Health. Now, this event was, there were so many people out here today. Can you tell us a little bit about what happened?
Yeah, absolutely. So we had various programs from Metro Health and from the community here represented. We were offering COVID vaccines, flu vaccines, STD testing, glucose testing, and there was also food bags that were given away by Gonzaba and from the food bank. So there were over 300 food bags that were distributed today. So it was a great event overall.
I saw a lot of people carrying around bags of fresh vegetables.
Yes.
And they were really excited about that. That's so cool.
Yes, they had fresh vegetables, canned goods as well from the food bank.
Awesome.
They each distributed about 300 each. And
yeah.
We administered over 60 vaccines to individuals looking for their COVID vaccine.
Wonderful.
A lot of first timers. So
awesome.
Still people out there looking for their vaccines as well.
That's great. Now, do you have any events like this happening in the future for people to look out for, or anything that you want folks to know?
Sure. So if you go to our website at sanantonio.gov, you will see all of our different events that we have planned to include vaccination events and also outreach events for STD testing and the different services that Metro Health has to offer.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much, Miguel, for having us here. As you can see, there's a lot of happy KSAT viewers who got their medals. But as you've been saying, the weather has been beautiful.
So nice.
Let's go ahead and toss it to Adam. He's got to look at the rest of your Fiesta
tossing
forecast.
To Adam.
Adam.
Tossing to Adam. Toss.
Got it. We got that one. Awesome. Love it. And I wish we could green up that grass that they're on, you know, the natural way and not having to water anything. And, you know, we mentioned that grass fire and that's on the south side and I-37 and I-10 roughly, I believe, but it's not on the satellite imagery yet, or not giving off a big enough plume to be visible to this satellite imagery. But you look just basically a little northwest of San Marcos, and there we have another wildfire, a bigger one there in Hays County. And if you're in the Canyon Lake area or New Braunfels, you can probably see that smoke plume off to the northeast of you. Unfortunately, we still have these very dry conditions. The wind is really slacking right now, which is a good thing. So it's not going to contribute to the very fast spread this evening and tonight. And actually, the wind's going to be completely calm overnight tonight. But we need more moisture. Instead, we just have the dry air and temperatures right now near average for this time of day. 78 San Antonio, 80 Hondo, 81 Pleasanton, Kerrville, you're 73, Converse area at 77. But by tomorrow morning, we're talking readings down in the lower 40s for most of us. Seguin, 41. Castroville, 41. Rio Medina, Bernie, Bulverde, 39. We'll likely see some upper 30s in parts of the hill country. And then by the afternoon, we make it back up near 80 degrees. So well below average in the morning, but near average by the afternoon. You look at the high temperatures, near 80 tomorrow, mid 80s this weekend, and then we see a little uptick on Wednesday. We make it back to 90 degrees. Well, 91 to be exact for the high temperatures, what we're expecting by the middle of next week on Wednesday. It's this dry air that's contributing to these grass fires that easily ignite and then can quickly spread. The air right now, dew points right now in the teens to near 20. Now, this is something we would love to have, say, come July or August, have a little break in the humidity. But right now, we would prefer to have the opposite because it takes that humidity in the air to make some rainfall. We're not going to have any of that humidity in the air till the end of the weekend and especially early next week, Monday and Tuesday, with dew points at that point into the 60s. So you'll feel mugginess then, but then another cold front comes and sweeps away that humidity. It's no surprise that Monday and Tuesday with that humidity, That's our only chance of storms in the 7-day forecast, and it's only about 20 to 30%. It's not that there aren't big systems out there to help trigger some precipitation. I mean, you look across the Great Lakes, the East Coast, big, broad, upper-level low that's just cranking. It's just not near us, and we're not having that activity move our way. And actually, here's the seasonal rain outlook for April, May, and June from the Climate Prediction Center. Doesn't look good for us. We're in that below average category. And actually, most of the western half of the United States is likely to be below average in terms of precipitation for that 3-month outlook. You look at our rain chances here over the next 7 days. Monday, 20%. Tuesday, up to 30%. Some pop-up showers and storms. If we see anything on Tuesday, then it could even become strong to severe. But tomorrow, wall-to-wall sunshine. 42 in the morning, near 80 by the afternoon. Northwesterly wind at only 5 to 10. But the wind picks up this weekend. You're going to notice it again. And a lot of sunshine next week, just that slight chance of storms.
All right. Thank you, Adam.
All right. Can the Spurs stay red hot on the road, Larry?
They certainly need to stay red hot on the road because they got to keep pace with those New Orleans Pelicans. Hey, since the Spurs clinched the play-in the other night, we haven't had a chance to talk to them, but this morning we did. Devin Vassell coming up. Plus, how's the QB battle going up in Austin? We'll hear from one of the Hornets receivers coming up next.
That's the biggest thing. We're just playing together as a team. Everybody has each other's back on defense, and we're all playing confident. Playing a
team like Devin down the Spurs will try to push their winning streak to 4 straight on game day. The Spurs are in Minnesota, where they'll face the Timberwolves tonight, and both teams are playing for something. Minnesota can still grab the 6th seed in the West and avoid the play-in tournament, but are guaranteed at least the 7th seed where they sit right now. And the Spurs are looking to move up from number 10 to number 9 so they can host the Pelicans in the play-in tournament. Yeah, the Spurs are happy they clinched a play-in berth.
Obviously, you know, we was excited. This is what we've been trying to do, and, you know, that was our goal, to get into the play-in. But, I mean, we're not satisfied with just getting to the play-in. Like, we want to make some noise and get these wins to where we can get in the playoffs. So, I mean, I think that's our main focus, honestly, right now.
Timberwolves will host the Spurs tonight at 7. DeJounte Murray is still out with an upper respiratory illness, and Lonnie Walker is out with low back tightness. Now, New Orleans clinched a play-in spot Tuesday night by taking care of the Kings, and that's pretty impressive when you consider they started off the season 1-12 with a 9-game losing streak, and Zion hasn't played this season due to a foot injury. Now the Pels want to close out strong and host the Spurs in New Orleans come play-in time.
Well, it's definitely what we want, and we have a few more games left to solidify that, but there's work to do. We know that. The guys were in the locker room talking about it, but it's also important, like I said, you have to celebrate these moments because you just never know when you get the opportunity to do it again. And they've worked so hard to put themselves in this position, and they believe, they trust it, and we're all proud of them.
Pels will host the Blazers tonight at 7, and they are favored by 17 points. So the Spurs-Pelicans play-in game is scheduled for Wednesday night at 8:30, sight to be determined. Up in Austin, the Longhorns are going through spring football drills, and Texas figures to have one of the hottest quarterback battles in the country this offseason. Can sophomore Hudson Card hold off former 5-star recruit and Ohio State transfer Quinn Ewers? Hudson has the upper hand because he played for Coach Sark last season. Here's wide receiver Xavier Worthy on the QB competition.
Quinn, he put some zip on that thing, so, but they both throw a pretty good ball. It's a QB battle. They're both doing really good right now, so I'm excited to see how that turns out.
Ewers is the Horns' highest-rated quarterback since Vince Young in 2002. Today was the final press conference for Ryan Garcia and Emmanuel Tego before the two boxers square off Saturday night at the Alamo Dome in the main event. San Antonio boxer Gregory Morales will show off his skills on the undercard. The Jefferson alum is 13-0 with 8 knockouts and will fight in the Dome where he walked the stage when he graduated from Jeff.
It's a blessing, and it's crazy because, like I said, you know, I was walking down that same aisle, that same little space. I was walking down it, and I was like, yo, I graduated here like 3 years ago, and now I'm fighting here, and it's crazy. It's crazy. I still can't wrap my head around it.
Gregory is scheduled to fight Katsuma Akitsugi in an 8-round featherweight fight. And the undercard starts Saturday at 3:30 p.m. at the Alamo Dome. How cool is that? He graduated from there, and now he's fighting there.
Deja vu, right? Yeah.
Thanks, Larry.
You got it.
We'll be right back. Now to the Trump-era COVID immigration policy that is set to expire. It's called Title 42, to some known as the asylum ban, and it all comes to an end on May 23rd. It restricts migrants from entering the U.S. because of the pandemic.
Governor Greg Abbott threatening to send migrants to D.C. It comes as Republicans are holding up key pandemic funding on Capitol Hill if that policy isn't reinstated. ABC's Morgan Norwood has the story.
Mounting tensions over Title 42, also known as the asylum ban, just days after the CDC announced it would end the Trump-era measure blocking migrants from entering the country, the state of Texas says it's prepared to send busloads of undocumented immigrants to the steps of the U.S. Capitol, but they would have to volunteer. Governor Greg Abbott directing state agencies to charter buses and planes straight to D.C.
We are sending them to the United States Capitol, where the Biden administration will be able to more immediately address the needs of the people that they are allowing to come across our border.
Title 42 was implemented at the onset of the COVID-19 pandemic. The Trump administration claimed it was to help prevent the spread of COVID across the border. The Biden administration announcing last week the order will end on May 23rd, with Homeland Security in the meantime receiving more vaccine doses and preparing other health measures to deal with the estimated 18,000 arrivals per day once that policy expires.
The southern border, no matter what they do, they're not going to be prepared for the number of individuals that are going to be presenting themselves.
Migrant advocates telling ABC News they're equally concerned, worried this will result in migrant dumping. Hanging in the balance, a $10 billion COVID-19 relief bill that some Republican lawmakers have vowed to reject if Democrats block a vote to reinstate Title 42. White House Press Secretary Jen Psaki blasting Republicans for, quote, moving the goalposts yet again, saying this funding is critical.
This is 385 pages of information we have given to Capitol Hill to make clear to them what the impact will be if we do not get this funding.
Meanwhile, in Texas, officials say they will ramp up military activity along the border. The White House press secretary also telling ABC News that DHS will implement significant measures for people who cross the border illegally. I'm Morgan Norwood, ABC News, Los Angeles.
Meanwhile, the Justice Department blocking the National Archives from sharing details of some of former President Trump's records with Congress. The records in question are the ones he took with him to his Florida residence after he left the White House. In a letter, the agency told Congress it's unable to respond to the panel's request for more information on the Mar-a-Lago boxes. Congress is looking into whether or not the former president broke the law by taking 15 boxes of records, including classified information, to Mar-a-Lago.
House Speaker Nancy Pelosi has tested positive for COVID-19. Her spokesperson made that announcement on Twitter today. She's reportedly not having any symptoms. Pelosi is vaccinated and boosted. She will quarantine according to CDC guidelines now. Her spokesperson also saying that a congressional trip to Asia during their two-week break will now be postponed.
Coming up after the break, the USDA saying food prices are only going to increase in the near future. Find out why and how much coming up. The Department of Agriculture says you can expect the price of food to continue skyrocketing. Prices already up 9% on average for the year. The USDA says they'll go up 4.5% to 5% more. Restaurant prices forecast to rise even faster, up to 6.5%. Particularly impacted will be beef and veal, which are expected to increase up to 7%. Avian flu also causing chicken prices to go up about the same amount. Fresh vegetables, though, expected to see the smallest change to their current prices.
According to the latest data on unemployment claims, there are far more available jobs than there are workers. The data shows that current jobless claims match a low that was set back in 1968. Today, the Labor Department says that claims fell to 166,000 at the end of last week. That's far fewer than the 200,000 or so that economists predicted. Continuing jobless claims stood at 1.5 million at the end of March.
You know, one of the many things I love about Fiesta is the fact that we get to get out and meet some KSAT viewers, interact, tell some stories, and give stuff away.
It's always a good time, and out there doing just that today, meteorologist Sarah Spivey and Katie Blake. This was a medal giveaway, but also a chance to get some health information out there, too.
Absolutely.
You know, that music plays at the beginning and then it stops, but we just
want to keep on dancing. This was a great event put on by Metro Health, free COVID vaccines, mm-hmm. information about screenings for different kinds of diseases that they put on. It was really great. There were so many people, so many booths here, and the KSAT booth. Oh my gosh. How many medals did we give away?
More than 200.
It was incredible how many people were out here wanting that Weather Authority medal. So much so that Katie and I don't even have a Weather Authority medal right now on us.
They're gone.
Because they were
no
gone.
More.
But this was really great. But we do have a couple more medal giveaways across KSAT, right?
Yes. Tomorrow, Friday, another round of KSAT medals, another round of SA Live medals. So watch for that information in the morning and also on our social media channel. So not done just yet, but no more Weather Authority medals. It was a great year. We so enjoyed reconnecting with our viewers, some of them we hadn't seen since 2019, so this was great.
Absolutely. And again, a great event put on here by Metro Health. It feels awesome out here, especially in the shade. So I'm sure Adam's going to have some more information about the forecast. But for now, meteorologist Sarah Spivey, meteorologist Katie Blake, reporting live from Mission Marquee Plaza.
Bye.
All right. Thank you, ladies. Look outside with live cam right now. They said it. It's a beautiful day out there, and it is crisp. It feels crisp this time of year.
They were not wrong. 77 out there right now, Adam.
Yeah, it's amazing for this time of year and to have Fiesta, you know, with actually comfortable conditions. But, you know, we need some rainfall around here, and unfortunately, no good chance, at least not within the next couple of days. Right now, nothing but sunshine, clear sky. We're going to cool quickly this evening. 78 now, but by 8 o'clock, 72. 10 o'clock, 61. And then tomorrow morning, we're going to have some unseasonably cool readings. We'll dive into those details, how cool and where, and talk more about that next chance of storms in just a bit.
H&M releasing a new line of compostable baby clothes for newborns. The clothes made from organic cotton. They're 100% biodegradable, so there are no buttons or metal trim, and even the pigments used to print the designs, biodegradable.
Hmm. There are 12 pieces to choose from, and they'll be on sale in May. The new line is just one of the number of ways the company is working to make fashion more sustainable and keep clothes out of landfills. All right, pour yourself a cold one, because today is National Beer Day. Even a national day, Adam Caskey can get behind. Did you know that beer is the third most popular drink worldwide? Comes to behind water and tea. It's also the world's one of the world's oldest drinks, possibly dating back to 9500 BC.
There are many different types: light beer, lager, Belgian porter, ale, you name it. So beer we go. Grab a cold one and toast to one of America's favorites. National Beer Day, appropriately falling during Fiesta and NIOSA.
You guys want to have your IPA debate?
We don't have enough time, right?
This is only an hour show. Yeah. I'm sorry.
I need like 12 hours for that. Okay?
You notice I didn't mention IPAs and the different types of beer.
I noticed you did.
I only mentioned the good kinds.
It's on.
You have lager beer. You have ale beer. It's anyway. We don't have to get into it.
Yeah, let's not.
Let's have cool temperatures for the morning. And the next couple of mornings are going to be unseasonably cool. I mean, we're talking 42 degrees near sunrise tomorrow morning. Even Saturday, early risers, about 48 degrees. So let's start off with our current readings right now. And you'll notice we're near 80, many of us in the 70s. 78 officially in town, Kennedy 78 along with Uvalde. You get to Comfort 76, Canyon Lake Bulverde 74, and Stinson 81 degrees. But look at the map. This is what we're expecting tomorrow morning. Sabinal, Hondo 41, Seguin 41, some upper 30s. Briefly in parts of the hill country. So Bandera, Kerrville, about 39 degrees around 7 a.m. tomorrow. Then by the afternoon, we're back near 80 degrees. And I think many of us actually just creeping into the lower 80s for a few hours. So Port SA about 82, 81 New Braunfels, and Divine 83. Here are the details for Battle of Flowers Parade, though. And I know the parade's a lot earlier in the day than usual, and even fiestas earlier than usual. But nonetheless, compared to what we're used to with Battle of Flowers, when we're just sweltering under the bright, hot sun, this is a little different. I think the Vanguard is 8:55 a.m. That's when that starts. It's going to be about 57 degrees then. By 11 a.m., we're closer to 70. And 1 p.m., we're in the mid-70s. So for those of you hitting the parade route and lining that route very early before the parade starts, have long sleeves ready to go and then short sleeves and shed that layer later on, because with that bright sunshine, we'll warm up quickly and efficiently. But not humid, not muggy. And that's because of these dew points. Dew points are down in the teens right now. Very dry air. We're talking desert air in place, which is why we have these really cool mornings, but then near average and comfortably warm afternoons. But dew points are way down. They're not really going to ramp up again until the end of the weekend and especially into early next week. Monday and Tuesday, you'll notice the stickiness back in the air. At that point, we're talking dew points in the mid-60s, so muggy and sticky at that point. But another cold front comes and sweeps away that humidity. It's no surprise that the only chance of showers is when we have that humidity back in the air for Monday and Tuesday. But don't get your hopes too high, because it's just a slight chance of a few storms. Here's the new drought monitor. It's updated every Thursday. Maverick, Dimmitt, LaSalle, parts of McMullen County, that's where we have the worst drought conditions, considered the exceptional category there in that darkest color. But even the red, the extreme drought, is creeping eastward and starting to fill in other parts of the KSAT 12 viewing area, even western Bexar County. Other parts of the state have had improvement, including Dallas-Fort Worth area and parts of East Texas, but still 85% of Texas considered in drought. There's active weather out there. We're in an active weather pattern, just not here. I mean, look across the eastern, basically half of the nation in the northeastern portion, and you got the Great Lakes stretching to the mid-Atlantic, parts of the mid-south, big, broad, upper-level low-pressure system, a lot of moisture with it. It's just not hitting us. Tomorrow, wall-to-wall sunshine again, not much of a breeze. That's going to be a good change in pace. A northwesterly wind at only 5 to 10, but the wind ramps up again for the weekend. We're talking gusts probably close to 30 miles per hour again Saturday and Sunday. So that's not going to be good for the fire weather danger, for the spreading of any wildfires. High temperatures, mid-80s through the weekend. Mornings back into the 60s or near 60 by Sunday, and just a 20 to 30% chance of some storms Monday and Tuesday.
Whew. Y'all right there?
Been busy lately, very busy lately. So I've got a winner for you. Haven't had time to be working on that thermometer that I've been updating you on, taking you step by step. I've just got a winner for you this week. Catherine Long of Marion, Texas. And you can go to ksat.com/thermometer up top, the big banner, click on it, and you can put your info in there. And then you're in the system to be randomly selected, hopefully at some point, to win a homemade thermometer. So Catherine Long of Marion, congratulations.
You've been giving away a lot of thermometers, though, this week.
Well, and that's another reason I've been busy. I've been busy putting them all together, because at the medal giveaways, we do the little drawings of the little cart tickets, and I've been giving away a ton of them. So,
had a few things going on.
Had a few things.
Yeah. All right. Thanks, Adam.
Mm-hmm. In case you missed it, coming up next.
Thursday, April 7th.
City council members just voted to settle a 2018 Sanctuary Cities lawsuit filed against SAPD Chief William McManus by Texas Attorney General Ken Paxton.
The lawsuit was filed nearly a year after the chief released 12 suspected undocumented immigrants found inside a tractor trailer on the east side, rather than handing them over to federal immigration officials. Now, the state will drop both this lawsuit and a second that sought to remove McManus as chief. The city will not admit any fault, but it will have to pay $300,000. That's on top of the $6.4 million the city says it has spent on these lawsuits so far.
Heavy damage and a woman sent to the hospital after a fire this morning on C Street. Firefighters say that when they got there, a man, son, and daughter were still in the home. The father and son got out okay, but the dad returned for his daughter. She suffered smoke inhalation and had to be taken to the hospital to get checked out.
On this vote, the yeas are 53,
The nays are 47, and this nomination is confirmed.
Truly an historic day as the Senate confirmed the first black woman to the nation's highest court.
Judge Ketanji Brown Jackson secured her place in the U.S. Supreme Court, giving President Joe Biden a bipartisan endorsement for his effort to diversify the high court.
If you didn't make it out to Coronation last night, there's another performance tonight at the Empire Theater. After a nearly three-year COVID hiatus, the satirical show made its grand return, and it's not pulling any punches.
Everything from the pandemic to Snowmageddon, and the Capitol insurrection, even Russian President Vladimir Putin, all included.
You know, the average low temperature, 57 degrees. We're going to be near 42 tomorrow morning and some upper 30s in the hill country. Then sunny, warming quickly, near 80 by the afternoon. Luckily, not as much of a wind. We're talking northwest at only 5 to 10. The wind is already starting to pump the brakes out there, and it's really going to be calm tonight. So into the weekend, upper 40s Saturday morning, mid-80s by the afternoon, a warmer morning on Sunday near 60, but gusty this weekend, and then a slight chance of storms by Monday, Tuesday.
All right. Thank you, Adam, and thank you for watching the news at 6.
See you on the night beat at 10.